So let's do our usual, create a console app. Nuke all that. Include IO stream and string. And for some reason in my notes here, I have include C time, but I don't remember why. Maybe it'll become self-evident. So above main, I'm going to define some functions. I could actually put them below main, but then I'd have to put the prototypes as well, which would be good practice, but whatever. Oh, and I forgot to do our using namespace std. So the first thing I'm going to add is a function called pause. And all it's going to do is say type OK to continue. So string s, cout, type OK to continue. And then cin into that s variable. And we don't even do anything with that. It's just a, you know. There's also a system call available, you know, in Windows. I'm not sure if it's available, you know, in Bash or whatever, on the Windows, excuse me, on the Mac or Linux, where you can do system parentheses pause, and it'll do the same thing. But now I want to use random numbers. Oh, my notes here say, okay, I see why I included C time. If you have random numbers, in general, the libraries that are included in Java or C++ or Python generate what are known as pseudo-random numbers. And a pseudo-random number is a series of numbers that, given the same starting point, will always be the same, which really wouldn't be very fun, you know, if you had a Yahtzee program and it always rolled the same dice, you know, each time in sequence. Well, if you seed that random number generator with a different number, you can modify the sequence. So, you know, if you say, okay, I really want you to start with 10 rather than whatever random number you used to start with, then it'll generate a different sequence. It'll still generate the same sequence every time, but at least it'll start different. The way people get around the fact that pseudo-random numbers always follow the same sequence is to give it a seed that is based on some value that's outside of the user's control. Time is a great example of that. You know, you seed your random number generator with the system time, and then, you know, unless they happen to run at the same program at the same exact system time, they're going to get a different series of random numbers. So in order to get the system time, we have to use the CTime library. So that's why we did include C time. So we are going to be using the srand function. There are other more elegant ways of generating random numbers. There are classes, but srand will work. So we're going to write a function called seedRandom. And it doesn't take a value because instead of letting the user or the programmer specify the seed, we're just going to generate one randomly. So int seed is equal to time 0. And by the way, this little method that I'm doing here is probably going to generate a warning that we'd have to get rid of with some cast statements. And then call srand with seed. And then just return. We don't even need a return statement. It's a void function. I'm going to compile what I have so far to make sure that I haven't broken anything yet. So far, so good. It doesn't do anything, but great. Now we're going to write a function called getRandom, where you specify a minimum and then you specify a maximum. And the reason for that is that the random number generator that we are using as part of srand generates a random number between 0 and the maximum value that an int can hold. And we don't want a random number of 8 million or whatever if you're trying to simulate, you know, dice rolling. You'd want a number between 1 and 6, or, you know, if you're doing a D&D game, between 1 and 20 or whatever. You don't want a number between 1 and 8 billion. So this random function will limit, will convert the value to the range that we want. And it will do so with modulus. So int get random num, and we want to specify a max, we want to specify a minimum, and then we want to specify a max. That way we're creating a range. We may not always want our random numbers to start with 0, which is perfectly plausible according to the C++ rand function. So if you're simulating a die, you're going to want to pass in a 1 as a minimum and a 6 or 20, or, you know, if you're rolling a dodecahedron, a 12. I really don't think there are enough games that use 12-sided dice anymore. Okay, so the range is equal to the max minus the min plus the 1. That's just to calculate our range, you know. If you say 1 to 6, then the range is equal to 6 minus 1 plus 1. So it's a range of 6 numbers. And we're going to use that to do modulus. And then r, int r, which is our random number, is equal to random, parentheses, in parentheses. We're calling the built-in random function. It's weird that the language has a built-in random function. Most languages, you have to import a library in order to do that. So it's a random number modulus the range plus the minimum. And we could work out the math on that if you care to. But if you do modulus by 6, then this is going to generate a number between 0 and 5. And then by adding the minimum back on it, we'll have 1 to 6. And the reason I'm doing 1 to 6 is, you know, we're used to 6-sided die in our Monopoly games or whatever. Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm sorry, what the modulus number does again?
Modulus means remainder. So if you have 7 modulus 4, what that means is 7 divided by 4 and then take the remainder. So 7 divided by 4 gives you a remainder of 3. So 7 modulus 4 is equal to 3. Does that make sense?
Yeah, by writing that right there, it says that you take the range out of it.
Right. This number can be any number between 0 and 8 billion or whatever the max in an int is. So let's say that it generated the number 101. Okay. We want to turn that into a number between 1 and 6. We've determined that our range is 6. You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we're going to modulus this by 6. I should have chosen a number that I could do off my head. Let's make that 121. Okay, so 121 modulus 6. Well, 6 goes into 120 20 times with a remainder of 1. And then we add 1 to it, which is our minimum, and we get a value of 2. If this had been 120, then when we modulus it by 6, we get 0. And 0 plus 1 is equal to 1. And if this was that maximum value, 125, then 125 modulus 6 is equal to 5. And if we add 1 to it, we get a 6. So we're generating a random value between 1 and 6 with this formula. Is that good? Very good question. All right, now we have a random number generator. Let's test it out. Make sure it does something. I'm going to go down here. I kind of wish that I hadn't made getRandomNumber such a long function name. I think I'm just going to call it getRND. I changed the name of the function to getRND because I want to do stuff like this. Cout getRND end of line. And heck, let's put that in a for loop. For int I is equal to 0, I is less than 10. Let's do it 10 times. I plus plus C out, get RMD. And I want my numbers to start with a 1 and end at 10. That's my range. And it doesn't work. I get an error, but I forgot to put a return value. Yep. Get RND needs to return R. There we go. It generated 10 random numbers. They are pseudo random numbers. I'm not calling this seed function. So the next time I run it, they should be the same values. 2, 8, 5, 1, 10. Every time I run it, I'm going to get that series of values because they're not true random numbers. Now, people go to extraordinary lengths to try to create true random numbers, like, you know, basing them on a cesium clock or the number of particles picked up, you know, from solar radiation or whatever, you know. But for game purposes, using the time clock to generate a series of pseudo-random numbers is totally cool. But I'm getting the same numbers because I didn't call my seed function. So above that for statement, I'm going to do seed random parentheses in parentheses. And then I'm going to run it, and now it's a different sequence of numbers. I run it again. I get another different sequence of numbers. I would have to run it a great many times in a row before I got the same sequence of numbers because the value of the time is a very large value. If I go out here and I print out the seed value inside of seed random, it's going to be a pretty big number. Say 1,461,000 or whatever. It's a number of milliseconds past 1970 or something like that. It returns the time since January 1, 1970, measured in seconds. So it's a pretty large number. By the way, that's why you could, at one time, totally freeze your iPhone or your iPad by setting it to a date before January 1, 1970. They fixed that bug, but you could grab somebody's phone, go in, set the date, you know, to December 25th, 1969, and hand it back to them, and then when it crashed, they'd never be able to reboot it. Okay. All right. Everybody get it going this far. If not, that's totally okay. I can print it out, or I can come back and help you. Did you include C time up at the top? I can do better than that, but yeah.
Can you scroll down, please?
Pardon?
Can you scroll down, please?
Yeah, sure. Or why don't I print out a copy for you too? I know, you're saying, all I did need is for you to scroll down, dude. Okay, there we go.
Now, if you're getting that warning, ignore that warning. This probe, I'll click on that. Return space R. That would take some thinking in order to explain what it was doing, but it was copying the value of 10 into I and then deciding that since that was a non-zero value, it was true, so it was going into an internal loop. Sorry.
Okay. All right, so we have the tools now to randomly fill an array. Let's fill an array of 1,000 elements. Int, I'm just going to call it data for fun. And I'm going to initialize it all to zeros like that. Otherwise, it's not initialized. I'm using an initializer list, but if you only give one value to it, then the rest of it is zero. So I'm giving it the first value as a zero, and then all the rest of them are two. Now, there are more than one way you can iterate through an array. And we covered these last time, but that was a week ago, and our brains have reset since then. One way is with a for loop like this, using an index value. I'm just going to use I again. I should probably use the word index, but just know that I means index. For int I is equal to 0, I is less than 100. This is not a real good way of doing it. Why? Because I'm hard coding 100 here, and if I wanted it to be 200 or 1,000 or something like that, I should change it. You know, I'd have to change it in both places, but I'm going to live with that just for a moment. And then data at element I is equal to get R&D. And I don't know, maybe it'd make it a number between 1 and 1,000. Now that's one way to step through it.
That's the traditional way. That's the C way of stepping through an array. More recently, C++ copied Java and introduced a couple of different ways of stepping through an array with a for each syntax. And the PowerPoint may call it something different than for each. Let's go look at it.
They call it a range-based for loop. But it's for each. The syntax, if you ignore the ampersand, is for every value in the numbers array, do something with it. So we're going to print out every value with our range-based for loop, also known as a for each loop, which you'll see again if you take Java or C++ or Python. So after our for loop, let's do this. For int value colon in my array, which was called data, cout that value, followed by endl. And it's going to print 1,000 numbers, you know, which is not super impressive, but we'll at least see a bunch of numbers scrolling by. There we go. It printed out 1,000 numbers. This is called a range-based for loop, so I'm going to add a comment above it. Print the values with a range-based for loop, also known as a for each loop. Some languages actually have a different keyword. It's for each instead of for. Java does not do that. In the Java, this syntax is copied exactly from the Java programming language. It's cool when languages do that. You know, somebody invents something cool, then other languages adopt it. Okay, what would be a cool thing to do next? Well, we could calculate the average. We've done that before. We would have to add up all the values. Oh, and I'm going to put another comment up here above this one. Assign the values of the array randomly with a for loop. I could print them the same way. I'm going to copy this code and then I'm going to put it right underneath it, except instead of assigning the value, I'm going to see out that value. Okay, so that's doing it with a for loop. To reference an array, you use the index value to get out each element in turn, starting at element 0 and going up to element 99. I really should have declared 100 as a constant. I'm going to come up here and do that. I'm going all the way to the top of main, and I'm going to declare a constant int array in all caps is equal to 100. And then I'm going to find every instance of the number 100 and replace it with that word. That way, if I wanted to change it to 10,000 or a million, I could do so. I don't think a million would work. I think we would run out of memory, but it might be fun to try. So one thing to notice is, why is this loop kind of cool, the range loop? Well, look how you're referencing the data. You don't have to reference it with this I syntax. It's easier to write. Also, you know, the header of the for loop is easier to write. You're not having to give it a starting point and an end point. You know, this way, it just steps through the array. It knows when the array begins and ends. You don't have to say start at 0 and go to 1 minus the end of the array. So the syntax is much, much cleaner. So if you can get away with doing this, this is a really cool syntax to be able to use. The only drawback to this is that you no longer have the index value. If you wanted to print like element 0 is equal to this, and element 1 is equal to this, and element 2 is equal to that, you'd have to use this kind of loop. I'm going to run it again, and then I'm going to increase that array size to, 10,000. See if that works, and then make it a million, see if that works. Okay, 100 works. Now, once we change it to these larger values, it's going to take a lot longer to run. We probably will not let it run, you know, to completion. But it's 100 right now. I'm going to change it to 10,000. Cool. A program caused the program to stop working. Let's run it in debug mode and see what the error is, if it'll tell us. Unhandled exception. I'm assuming that what has happened is that we ran out of memory. But I can't prove that. I'm gonna change 10,000 to 5,000 and try it again. It's really not a very big array size, so I'm surprised that we ran into trouble doing that. Have I done something stupid? Let me change it back to 100. Works. 500. Stack around the variable data was corrupted. That means that I wrote past the end of data. And you want to know why? I probably declared it as being size 100. Yep, right there. I didn't fix that. So this is a good example of what happens when you write past the end of data, write past the end of a buffer. All of my for loops said go out to 500, but I declared my data as being 100 long. I missed that 100 when I was fixing all references to 100. Now I should be able to go back here and change this to 10,000 again. And it's just going to take forever. But if I was going to write a sum function without printing this data, you know, if I came down here and I commented out the print statements, it would go through that lickety-split. Why? Because it's a 3 gigahertz computer. It doesn't take very long to run through an array of 10,000 numbers. I kind of feel like doing that, so I'm going to comment out these loops that print the data. We had two loops, or at least I did, that printed out the data. One was the for loop and one was the for each. Now I want to sum the data in that loop. I have to declare a variable to hold the max. I'm going to declare it as a double. I'm going to call it sum. I'm going to set it equal to 0. And then I'm going to use a ranged for loop to get all those values and add it to the sum. So for every value that is in the data, sum is plus equal to that value. And then I can print out the average. Cout average is, which is equal to the sum divided by the length of the array, which we defined as array in all caps. And bam, it ran so fast that I couldn't even watch it, you know? I'm gonna change 10,000 to 100,000 and see if it takes an appreciable amount of time to do that. Pardon me while I scroll up and do that. I'll come back down here really quickly. So I changed my constant to 100,000 rather than 10,000. It's still going to run pretty quickly. Yeah, 100,000, lickety split. That's how fast computers are nowadays. If you did that in the 1940s, you know, it would have been running a week in order to count, you know, 100,000. Well, I'm going to try a million then. See, by defining it as a constant, I don't have to go and modify every place I use that number. Okay, a million took a little longer, and it generated an error. I'm going to run that debug mode and see if it tells us what the error was. Stack Overflow. Okay, you know, each program, when you launch it, Windows gives it a certain amount of stack space, which is, you know, memory allocated to the program for it to use. We have exceeded the amount of memory that was allocated to us. I'm curious as to what our what size that array was, but I can't think of a good way of figuring that out. So I'm going to change it to 500,000 to see if that helps. 5 followed by 5 zeros. No. But 100,000 worked.
Can you print it to a text file?
That would be a lot faster, yeah. Yeah.
You can see how the size of it too.
200,000. 400,000. 200,000 and 400,000. 300,000. When you compile these programs, you could specify the amount of stack space that you want Windows to give it, or your operating system to give it, and you can give it a lot more memory. So if you're dealing with extraordinarily large arrays, then you can say, I need this much space for it. All right, typically what people do at this point is, you know, write some functions that will sort the data, you know, and then measure how long it takes to sort the data for differing amounts of sizes. I hadn't come prepared to do that, so I'm going to pop open and type in a sort array of ints in C++ and just see what pops out at us. There is a sort function in the standard library. However, it uses vectors, and I didn't want to use vectors. I just wanted to use ints. Okay, I don't want to sort something that's that long. I want to be able to print it. So I'm going to lower its size down to 10. And after I have made the array, I'm going to sort it. So here's where we assign the values of the array. I'm going to uncomment out my print loop, my first print loop with a for loop, and then I'm going to sort the data. And I'm going to do it with a function from the standard library called sort, where you specify the starting point of the array, and then you specify the ending point of the array, which is the data, the array, plus the length of the array. And that's not working. Sort is undefined. Let me go ogle this. Is it from pound sign IOStream or from pound sign algorithm? It's probably from pound sign algorithm. Excuse me while I go up here. I'll make it real clear in a minute what I've done once I get it working. What am I seeing here? What are these lower numbers? Oh, I still have my loop here that's running 10 times just to print out numbers. I'm going to comment that out. There's a for loop under the seed random call that we no longer need. So scroll up and where you see the call seed random and comment that out. Comment out the for loop, the two lines of code underneath that. Then scroll down to after the for loop that builds the data and uncomment out the print code, print the array with a for loop, and then add this sort command. The sort command will not work unless you have a pound sign include up at the very top of the code, which says pound sign include and then the word algorithm, kind of like presidential candidate Al Gore. No, I'm sorry. That's not right. Anyways, and then print it out again. So uncomment out the second print statement as well. And I'll wander around and help everybody get that. So the include you need up at the top is include pound sign algorithm, A-L-G-O-R-I-T-H-M. You're going to need that. You're going to want to uncomment out those print. That's how you spell algorithm, like you could read my writing. You're going to want to comment out those print loops, and you're going to you want to put the call to sort between the two print loops. And the data is sorted.
we can increase this array back up to 200,000. And then we could time how many seconds long it took for it to sort 200,000 numbers. I know I was scrolling up and down a lot, so if you need a printout, that is totally okay. Raise hands so I can count. All right, about 20 of them? Okay. 40? Just kidding. Time function that we use to seed the value, seed the array, we could use as a measure of how long it took to run. So I'm going to go to my code, and above the call to sort, I'm going to put long start is equal to time. I'm getting an error. Too few arguments in function call. What have I done? Time parentheses 0. And then after the call to data, I'm going to do long end is equal to time. And then long seconds is equal to end minus start. And then lastly, let's print that out. C out took for sort time, sort space time equals followed by seconds. Now this ran so quickly that it said 0 seconds, you know. It can't. There are other time functions, you know, that'll return the time in milliseconds, and maybe even one that'll do it in nanoseconds, which would be much more precise. I think we used that last time. Or maybe I'm misremembering the class. I need to print out my for loops. Excuse me, I need to comment out my for loops again, because I'm going to change it to generate an array of 200,000 again, and I don't want to print out 200,000 numbers. So before and after your sort call, print out your comment out your for loops again. And then run it and make sure that it just says sort time is equal to 0. And then crank up your array size to 200,000. Or at least start off with 1,000. See if it takes any time at all. Still took 0 seconds for 1,000. 10,000. Still took 0 seconds. 100,000. A little bit of time. It took a whole 1 second. 200,000. Still took 1 second. I wish now that I'd remembered how to increase the stack space so that we could get it to where it would actually take, you know, more than 1 second in order to do the sorting. All right, that is about enough about arrays. I really shouldn't end the lecture here. I guess there's one more thing I want to tell you, is that range-based for loops, you cannot change that value. You can, but it doesn't change the original value in the array. And I know I mentioned this last time, but you can if you make this a reference variable instead.
So if you wanted to wipe out all the values in the array or change them so that they're all equal to one more than they used to be, you could do that. I'll show you the code for it, but it's pointless. There's no reason to do this in this particular program, but we could. So after my call to sort, I'm going to make a loop that adds one to the value of every element of my array. And it's going to look like this. Now, there's really no way I could prove that that's working, you know. Or I guess there's some things I could do to it. But, like, I could add 500 to the values, plus equals 500, and then see if the average was raised accordingly. Yeah, so it worked. If I had not had that ampersand there, then this loop actually would not have been able to modify the values of the arrays. Sorry about that. So the homework assignment, based on this in-class assignment, is to do essentially this, but to have it regenerate the random numbers over and over until all the numbers in the array are the same size. Just like if you were playing Yahtzee and you rolled 5 dice, are all the numbers the same? You know, great. That's when it stops. Otherwise, do it again. It keeps looping until it generates an array, you know, with all the numbers of the same size. So it's got code for checking to make sure that every element in the array is the same size. And there's a lot of comments in it. It's one of those times when I was a jerk and made it, you know, an image rather than code you could copy and paste. But don't type in the comments unless you just really, really want to. That'll speed up the typing of the code tremendously. And a lot of it you could just recycle from this, except for the fact that we changed one of the function names. If you start monkeying with the length of the array, you know, start it with like 5, a length of 5, just like in a Yahtzee game. It doesn't take long for the computer to generate, you know, 5 numbers that are the same, as, you know, unless the random numbers are of a big range. You know, if it's certainly between 1 and 6, it's going to certainly be like less than 100 rolls for it to get all 5 numbers the same. But then if you say, I want 7 spaces in my array, or 10, or 20, it'll run a lot longer before it generates a number that are all the same, a sequence that's all the same. So I will need to upload that. All right, so it's homework assignment 9. We'll make it due in a week. This may be pretty close to the last homework assignment because we only have 2 weeks left, you know. Which is too bad. There's so much more we need to cover. Okay. I made it in class assignment, which is not what I wanted to do. All right, if you open up the assignment, or I'll open it up here because I already do have it open, you'll see that it's very similar to what we already did. But then there's some extra stuff. So it starts off the same, you know? So you could just copy that code out of your in-class assignment It has the pause function, which we didn't even use. It has a seed random function. It has get random number, which we called get R&D. You can name that back to get random number and it would match what we did. And then it's got a silly little main, which calls main one. I have no idea why I did this. Oh, I see why. And then it just returns zero. So the whole point of that is just to type this in and then make sure it compiles. After you've typed the first page in, you'll actually see the code that does our work. And it's got a lot of documentation in it. You could kind of skip that if you wanted to. Main one fills an array of numbers with random numbers, like rolling dice in a Yahtzee game. It then counts how many rolls it takes to get five of a kind, if all the dice are re-rolled each time. You know, when you're really playing Yahtzee, you know, you roll five dice, and then if you got three fives, you only pick the other two and you roll them again, you know. But this time, we're re-rolling the entire handful of dice each time. So we initialize our array. Well, we didn't have to do it like that. We could do it with the syntax that we did our otherwise. But anyways, type the whole thing in. And I know it looks like a lot of typing, so, you know, expect to spend an hour on it. Whatever. Test and run it. See how many times it takes to roll five dice to get five of a kind. Repeat it a few times. It'll differ each time. Unless you call out to the seed function. If you comment out the seed function, it'll take the same number of times every time because it'll generate the same sequence. Change it to roll seven dice at a time. That'll take a lot longer to run. You could add that code in there, you know, the C time code. Excuse me. You could add that time code to make it show exactly how many seconds it took. Then change it so that the values are between 0 and 1. You just change minimum and maximum. So instead of 1 and 6, it'll 0 and 1. That'll run quite rapidly because you're just like flipping coins instead of generating random numbers. So if you comment out the printing of the array, it will run much more quickly. So comment out the printing, just like we did here. Set it to roll 10 dice with a minimum of max and a 1 of 6. Why do I have this? Don't do this main two part. I don't see the point of repeating that. I'll edit the homework so that it ends on page 3. So does that make sense? It's really mostly a matter of typing, but you're going to be experimenting with it. You're going to change the number of dice you're going to roll. You're going to change the minimum and the maximum value. It would be really cool, and I would be impressed if you added the time functions so that, you know, it would print how long it took as well as how many rolls it took. But, you know, at the very least, it's printing out how many rolls it took. So if you were playing along at home, it's kind of hard to follow along. So here's the final code. Pause the video as needed. Here's the first page of code. Here's the second page of code. All the way down to where we declare the array. There's the third page of code. After we declare the array, our for loop to assign random values of them, and then to sort them. And then we added a block of code to modify the values of the array, adding 1,000 each value. And then we calculated the sum and printed the average. We also have some loops in here that printed out the values of the array, but when you have 10,000 or 100,000 array elements, it takes too long to do that. You'll see in class Dropbox letter N. I need to put due dates on these. All right, now they have due dates.